Thank you for braving the cold.
My own wife is trapped in New Jersey, so that means I can say whatever I want to say now, and she can't stop me. Which usually she's the brakes usually on what I want to talk about. So I want to spend a little time walking you through the way I think about the concept of health, and in particular how you communicate these ideas. And I have to pay tribute to Oprah Winfrey, who taught me so much about this space, but also many other people. You just met two of them, who have been very influential in educating me to think very differently about how a doctor normally talks about health topics. And hopefully through the course of my conversation, you'll come up with some ideas and questions of your own. I've saved a lot of time at the end for us to focus in on the issues that matter to you, because if they matter to you, they're probably more important for me to address than things that I might think are important. So let's start off with my background a tiny bit. Ellen mentioned that Dick and I practiced together at New York Presbyterian. This is how I started my career. As a cardiac surgeon, I would replace these hearts, and I won't need this for a second. And in the operating room, it's sort of cool because you see these people whose hearts were failing and shriveling up like raisins, and you could put these pumps in them and allow them to slowly begin to resuscitate themselves and pump blood more aggressively to all the different extremities of the body. But as I would sit in my office, and this is my office, it gets a little crazy. This is like your office, by the way, I'm sure. It gets so busy that you don't have the time to just slow things down and really think through the process of what you're doing. And I was going through this process in my own mind, struggling with the bigger concepts that I thought were holding back patients, people who I thought could have avoided my need to take a bandsaw to their chest and do reparative surgery, in part because I wasn't thinking it through the right way. In fact, I think America doesn't get the health message oftentimes because we don't give it to you in a way that's palatable, exciting, uplifting. So we go to medical school because it's fun. We're thrilled with the things we learn, and somehow by the time we get into practice, after having explained it a few dozen times and then a few hundred times and then more, we start to treat it like it's rote, like it doesn't matter. And there's a thrill, a gusto, when you really appreciate the sacredness of the human body that we should never forget. So let me take you back to what, to me, the good life means. And it's a phrase that I've used independent of the magazine as well, but to me it's not about fast cars and lots of cash. It's about the people in your life. That's who defines your life. And when they're doing well, then you feel good, and that is the good life. And there's a brilliance to that process that we all appreciate. In fact, when we're children, we see it immediately. Small things give us lots of thrills. And there's an innocence to that process. When you first see something, I remember the first time I saw a heartbeat, I was petrified by it. It looked like a python coiling outside of the chest. And as that back came over, the metaphorical snake that was coiling in that chest, I realized the power in it. And over time, I went from being fearful of it to realizing it was hurt and needed help. And I began to caress it. But that innocence of the first time appreciating something is important. And then there's, of course, passion. If I had to describe one word or use one word that people often use to describe me, I use the word passion. And I make tons of mistakes. In my house, the prosecution never rests, so I hear about them a lot. But passion is something that I think we all have deep inside of ourselves, and when it oozes forward through the pores of who we are, people appreciate that. And I think when you're living a good life, you appreciate that passion. But at its very core, as I mentioned, it's about the people in your life, so it has to be about connection. And I think what most of us seek in life is an authentic moment of connection, when we can look in each other's eyes and it matters. And too often, we miss those moments of connection. There are many temptations that pull us away. The digital world certainly does it, which is one of the reasons that we're seeing more and more emotional problems linked to many of these devices and social media sites. But they have a role, too, if we use them the right way. But it comes into our life as a need for more connection. And of course, when you're youthful, you're beautiful. And why are you beautiful? Because outer beauty is a metaphor, and it's a reflection of inner health. And if you're healthy on the inside, you see it everywhere else. In fact, when you ask people what beauty is, they don't say it's the brow width or the color of your eyes. They first describe it as the texture of your skin, the glow of your hair, the body that you're in. And these are all, again, reflections of inner health. But what ends up happening? We forget, and it is a reality, they were imperfect. This is the left side of my face doubled, and the right side of my face doubled. And both of them look sort of strange to me. They probably do to you as well. But you see how asymmetrical I am. Unfortunately, it's true for almost all of you as well. And we forget how beautiful imperfection really is. I used to take my kids when they still go around the museums with me. As they get bigger, it's harder to do. But I would take them to the Natural History Museum. And I don't know if you know the gemstone exhibit in there. And I'd go to that exhibit, and I'd sit there with them. And dutifully, the girls, I have four kids, the three girls would sit there, and they'd write down the stones they thought they were taking home with them. They thought they were shopping. And so they'd fight over the Hope Diamond, because I said it first. And so, but there was a stone in the middle of this exhibit. It's a jade stone, and it's pristine. It's flawless. They never picked that stone. And you know why they didn't pick it? Because it's sort of boring. A jade stone without flaws, without blemishes, without a grain or a vein of gold, that's not that interesting. What makes jade beautiful are the flaws in it, like us. And so our imperfections actually make us who we are. They make us adorable to the people who care for us. They make others resentful of us, but it's at the very core who we're meant to be. And unfortunately, this is what we see in ourselves when we see imperfection. And when we start to run into these obstacles, it influences the way we look at the world around us. So what holds us back from changing if we're not happy with what we're looking at in the mirror? Well, time's the big issue. But of course, life's not about time management, it's about energy management. And if you're managing your energy right and it's giving you energy, then you should be able to make enough time. You certainly make time for the things that matter to you. Money's a big issue, although it's not quite as big as it seems. You know, once you get about $40,000 of income, the value of money dramatically decreases in your life. And it's very hard to discern significant differences in happiness in someone who's making $50,000 or $50 million. You know, once you get past that poverty level and paying the basic bills, those issues really are significantly diminished. Not to understate the value of having money. It's always nicer to make the decisions when you have a little bit more disposable income, but it doesn't seem to bring the happiness you would normally have anticipated it bringing. Knowledge is a big issue because people don't always know what to do, and we certainly, as I mentioned, have not made it easy to know what to do, but I don't think people change what they do based on knowledge alone. I wish it was that simple, but there are obstacles there, and we have ways of presenting that. And then there's fear of change, which is a huge problem, because you fear change because you fear that if you do change, people won't love you, and that's spiritual death. So I'm going to share with you one or two little clips from the show that I think might help elucidate some of these themes. The first one is an interview I did with someone who was fairly controversial. You probably would not have expected to see on my show, but it was, for me anyway, a sentinel moment. And it came down to me struggling with him to figure out why he couldn't open the door to health. Because like most of America, as his cartoon elucidates, he's pushing as hard as he can and the door to health couldn't open.
I think it's good. All knowledge is good, right?
Knowledge is good, but again, since we're being honest, I mean, I would at least in some part of my soul, if I were you, be thinking, these kids are gonna want to emulate me. They want to be like me.
Yeah.
You don't have that fear?
I do, of course, yeah. Yeah, and heightened now that you brought it up. Seriously. No, there's a lot to think about after. This is not just entertainment right now. There's some cathartic things happening here. This is deep. I haven't done an interview like this maybe ever.
So Charlie C is a very controversial figure for good reason. He almost invites it. Incredibly intelligent man. Remarkably gifted at the things he does. He memorizes the scripts for all of his shows at once. It's almost effortless for him. But obviously he has plenty of flaws, which makes him interesting to a lot of people, myself included, because you want to understand, how do I reconcile that? The craziness of what he does with the remarkable talents that he is able to apply to his art. But we're all like that. And the smarter you are, the better you are at lying to yourself, which is part of the tragedy of people who have immense talents who self-sabotage and throw themselves into the gauntlet of life in the wrong way. And so these are kinds of experiences are to me quite useful because they begin to elucidate different paths we can all take. But this is unfortunately what many of the viewers are doing, right? They're sitting home watching and trying to figure out if there's a role truly in what I'm saying for them as they have the clicker in their hands. And it comes to bear and comes to more light when you see it out in the field. Take a look.
We tested all kinds of people.
Are you ready?
I guess.
From all different places.
Pennsylvania, California,
North Carolina.
And all walks of life.
Come on up.
I'm Bob Green.
Hi, Jared.
You're having your tests done today,
yes.
So...
I was supposed to have it done for a while because I drink a lot of water. I'm always thirsty. You can never cure the thirst.
37-year-old Jared had never been tested for diabetes before.
This is Jared.
Hey, Jared, how are you?
Good.
You know, when they call the doctor over, that's not good news.
While that runs, I'm going to tell you that number's supposed to be under 6. The amount of sugar that's traveling around in your blood cells needs to be under that number. That's what it should be for all of us. Your number is 12.8.
Wow.
12.8 worries me a lot. That's more than twice what's tolerable.
Yeah. That's what I do about it.
What do I do about it? It's really the most important thing in the whole interview I did with him. He wanted to know how he could address a problem he just discovered he had. Now, I'm also equally concerned about the fact that he was urinating all the time, always thirsty, and felt tired. I mean, what's the diagnosis? It's diabetes. His blood sugar, by the way, was almost 500 when we took him to the emergency room directly from the set. So you could also look at it, you know, in a concerning capacity, because you would think that how could Jared not know he had diabetes? But the fact that he wanted to do something about it, and he did, by the way, losing a ton of weight, and like most people who lose a lot of weight, his blood sugars dramatically came down. When they plummeted, his need for medications nearly went away. That's the kind of outcome you want. But you have to put it on people's radar screen for them to appreciate that. So it brings me back to that question of how do we change? We know why we don't change. I just went through a couple of those excuses, and they really are excuses. So how do you make changes happen? And these are the things that I've learned from, you know, creating the TV shows. And, you know, by the way, you know, I spend a lot of time on the web, you know, on radio segments, as you guys probably hear in the morning. And, you know, we have those all over the country in newspaper articles. And I spend a lot of time trying to figure out how I'm going to tell this story with the magazine as well. And a lot of it comes down to these basic insights. Insight number one, people do not change based on what they know. They change based on how they feel. Think about that in your own lives, and even more importantly, in the lives of the people who you're trying to change. Because the next time you start beating them over the head with facts, realize that if you finger wag at somebody over something, it rarely has a desired impact, because they pretty much know what you're finger wagging about, because you probably told them 100 times, just like you're about to tell them you told them 100 times. What they really need to understand is emotionally why that matters. And I'll come back to this theme. Second issue is if you make it hard to do, people don't do it. We're not hardwired to do things that are difficult. If you make it easy to do the right thing, well, then all of a sudden it starts to happen. I'm reminded of a wonderful teacher I had when I was still a resident at New York Presbyterian. His name was Tom King. Some of you may know him. He was a wonderful surgeon in the city for years. And Tom grew up in, and lived most of his life in Utah before he came to Columbia. And they had a lot of snow in Utah. And he could never get his kids to clean the driveway from the snow, because he can get his car out of the driveway and go to work in the morning. So he was struggling with this, and he tried to bribe them, he tried to cajole them, you know, hit them, nothing, you know, metaphorically hit them, because he was a very passive man. But he could not get them to do this. Finally, one day it dawned on him what to do. He put up a basketball net. The snow never hit the driveway. It became much easier for them to take the snow away because they wanted to play basketball. And we have ways of doing that if we're thoughtful about it. It takes a little bit of cleverness, but it's much more impactful. You have to adore the solutions. We underplay the importance of that. In fact, when I'm asked about diets, and I'm sure it'll come up in some of your questions later in this conversation, the first rule of thumb is make sure you love what you're doing. Because if you don't love the food you're eating, you're not going to stay on it anyway, so who cares if it works? But if you can find foods that work and you adore them, and they happen to be healthy, well, of course you'll do them. That makes it a lot easier. And you got to, and you've got to live the good life. And you already see the magazine cover. We chose that title on purpose for that basic concept. And I like the thinking about this process to describe to you again ways that I'm trying to bring it alive. So this is an image, obviously, about skin. And one kind of skin, the baby's bottom, is the gold standard. And many of us think we look like an elephant's rear. But if you try to tell that story without visually arresting images, this is true in any media that I'm involved with. People wander by because the biggest enemy that I have is you think you know the answer already. And most of the time, there's something subtle, cool, interesting, edgy about the message that can attract you in. If I just make it clear, you don't already have the answer. So visual cues are an important one. People think that health is onerous. It's a sour and dour tip. This is a healthy message. I can't tell you how many interviews I did over the Super Bowl weekend, this was the last couple days, in the different media events, asking what my advice was for Super Bowl meals. And yeah, I can tell you to replace the sour cream with, you know, Greek yogurt, and it'll reduce the calorie count by 400, but people don't want to hear that, right? What they need to hear on Super Bowl Sunday is have a great time, because it's more important that you celebrate life and enjoy it, and then move on past it, then resent the fact that you were on a diet on Super Bowl evening. And that's a better message for most people to have. It's one of the reasons that I always tell folks who crave foods, eat what you crave, but just take a bite or two of it, then wash it down, because the first bite tastes fabulous, unbelievable. Second bite, half as good as the first bite. Third bite, ordinary. Fourth bite is hedonism. And so you can sort of put a stake in the sand and wash that taste out of your mouth and you move on and it's a better option. So I'd rather you have a chocolate chip cookies if you go in that direction. And if you're gonna go that path, smell the darn thing, but understand how your nose works. Because it is sort of cool to understand the subtlety of the way smell plays a role in our lives. And it's biologically absolutely imperative. And these aren't even sense that you can sense the way we think about smell. These are subconscious hormonal influences. You are naturally attracted to people in your life, even people that most people around you don't think you should be, because you like their scent. And their scent is, not the odor you sense in your nose, but the pheromone that comes through your nose. Children, daughters in particular, don't like their father's pheromones. That's a good thing. They're a little bit repelled by it. And it makes families stay together a little bit, but also repel a little bit to create a healthy dynamic. And these, again, we're hardwired to do these. As you appreciate these things, you become more curious about how our nose works. Or if I'm gonna quiz you, I can do it in a lot of ways, but instead of a tedious tactic, I'd rather say, quickly look at this image, and I won't quiz you today. But and see how many of these you can remember after a few seconds of keeping focused on it. And I can take it to the next level by reinforcing that as valuable as crossword puzzles are, and they are very important for our mental health, they're not as important as dancing. Because when you dance, in theory, you're using a series of coordinated actions, right? So your brain has to process physical activity, which takes a huge amount of brain power, as well as coordinating it. So it's an extra layer of requirement, which is why it's so valuable for mental health. If you look around the world where people live a long time, the one common characteristic they all share, if they're in a blue zone area, a place where they live to age 100, roughly 4 times more commonly than if they live in this country, they all share daily rigorous physical activity. That's how they get to live longer. It's something we often forget, which is why when you brave the snow, it makes me increasingly proud of your ability to be in that cohort. So congratulations. And then there's these issues of optimism. And people don't often look at design issues as part of the good life, but it's absolutely essential because colors play a huge influence in how we respond to the world around us. Yellow is a good example. My mother-in-law has a car just like that. She's a fascinating woman in many ways, really a matriarch of the family, but she's always loved yellow. And it turns out 60% of people, when surveyed across colors, find that yellow makes them optimistic. Turns out that colors also influence how much you eat. Restaurants will be red or blue depending on how much they want you to eat. Colors make a huge difference in your response to the outside world as well. So just taking a color like yellow and making it part of your life, because if you don't have a lot of sun in this time of the year, which we don't, it becomes increasingly problematic to find yellow, changes things like your mood in ways that are quite measurable. So these are the kinds of ways that I can nudge people towards trying to find the good life. We try to use every medium possible, tell the story every way possible to make that happen. So let me give you the single most important slide I'm gonna show today. And please write these numbers down if you have a pen and paper, have a desire to. Otherwise, use your mental capacity and memorize these 5. Because this slide describes the 5 big life adjustments that I'm gonna talk about. And they drive 70% of how well you age. And before you tell me that you don't want to live long, when you are older and you're 90, you'll want to live longer because if you're mentally intact, which most of you will be, and you're physically able to do what you want to do when you are 60, which most of you will be, then living past age 90 is a very desirous process. And that's where we live today in America, if you're actually in reasonable health already. So here are the 5 tips. And I'm going to go back over these again so you don't have to get them all the first time. First tip, blood pressure. The ideal blood pressure is 115 over 75. Now, the average blood pressure in America is 130 over 80. So 130 over 80, 85 is not the same as 115 over 75. In fact, the optimal blood pressure, that number up there, 115 over 75, will predict a life expectancy about 10 years longer than if you're hypertensive, high blood pressure. The average blood pressure seems good because it's the average number, but unfortunately the average person in America dies of heart disease, so it's not good enough. I'll come back to why in a minute. Second big tip, exercising 30 minutes daily. You can get that any way you want. I define exercise as breaking a sweat or getting a little breathy as you exercise. It translates into an increased heart rate, which is why I want that, but many of you don't check your heart rate. But that's what exercise means to me. A third tip is a healthy diet that's easy to love. Getting back to that concept that you have to adore it. Fourth tip, no cigarettes or toxins. And the fifth tip is to control stress. But how the heck do you do that? Right? Seems impossible. So let's just try one tactic that's been used for eons to deal with stress. Everyone take a deep breath. Really deep. Okay, now a bunch of you did this. All right, well, it's not alleviating stress. So let me show you what a true deep breath looks like. And you'll notice as I show this animation that it focuses on the diaphragm, which is a muscle you may not appreciate, but it exists right beneath the lungs and it pulls down on the lungs. And it does this. As you inhale, the diaphragm, which is that pinkish muscle, comes down, your belly goes out. As you exhale, belly goes in, diaphragm goes out. Inhale, bless you, the opposite happens. Watch carefully. Exhale, belly in, diaphragm up. Now, bless you. So, just deep breathing and sneezing together. All right, so I want you all to put your right hand on your belly so you don't bump into each other. Let's do it together. Now remember, with inhalation, where's the belly go? Out. Which is the opposite of what most people do instinctively, although as a child you did it the right way. So I'm gonna count to 8. 4 seconds in, 4 seconds out. During inhalation, push your hand out. During exhalation, really suck your belly button back towards your spine. Are you ready? Deep breath in, 1. Exaggerated, 2. 3, push your belly button out. 4, you feel a little aching in the xiphoid area, then relax the stomach. 5, 6, now pull that belly button towards the spine. 7, 8. That's a deep breath. If you watch kids sleeping at night, they do it naturally. If you watch athletes, they'll just without any difficulty belly breathe. Certainly singers do it, they're taught to do it. And many of us might have forgotten this, but in many mystic religions, in Christianity and Judaism, there are breathing exercises that focus in on this, Buddhism and the like. So it's out there, and we ignored it. Now, it turns out that deep breathing is something else. It sucks and entrains from our sinuses a gas called nitric oxide. And that gas, nitric oxide, there have been Nobel Prizes awarded for it, entrains with the air into your lungs, dilates up the lung beds, and brings you all the life-sustaining oxygen that our body needs. Which is why putting a breathing tube in somebody when we operate on them is actually not too good for them, because they don't get that nitric oxide anymore. But these simple little tactics are hugely important. But the best part of all, besides it being free, is you can sit in a board meeting with someone you don't like, you know, or across the dinner table with someone you despair, you know, absolutely despise, and you go, it's okay, JB. And let it all flow away. And they're on double secret probation and never knew it. And it's one of the reasons that deep breaths have been used for so many eons and so successfully. All right, let's shift gears to the second big issue that I brought up on that slide of 5 things to do, which is cigarettes and toxins. This image of a healthy lung. And when I talk to people who are smokers, and we'll start with that example, I always emphasize the absolute majestic nature of a healthy lung. It's like a sponge. It's fluffy, it's white, it's like a beautiful cotton ball that's sort of taking in everything around it. And unfortunately, what smokers don't really get this image. In fact, all they hear when we tell them that they're not smokers, you know, they shouldn't smoke, is that they're not good enough. That's what they process. And then they get nervous and they go smoke. We actually tried to do a study at Columbia where it was funded by the NIH, where we wanted to do a study on smokers who were not depressed. So we had this intake form. There's a quiz they needed to take to make sure they weren't depressed. And after 2 years, we gave the money back to the NIH. Didn't identify a single smoker who was not depressed. They would never acknowledge it publicly, but deep down inside, they were harboring a darkness that they were treating with their cigarettes. So instead of telling them, don't smoke, and worsening the situation, I just show them what smoking does to your lungs. This is a smoker's lung. Notice that at about 11 o'clock, there's a moth-eaten area that's chewed away. The dark tar deposits are evident. Living in the city makes your lungs darker too, by the way, but not like this. And when we see these kinds of lungs, it's tragic because you realize if you really saw that, if you really had a visceral awareness of what was going on, rather than this supertentorial understanding, you know, that we think about in their brains, if you really got it in your gut, you'd never smoke. So what I tell people is that all I want you to do is care enough about yourself that it matches what people around you think about you. Do it because at its very core, if someone you loved dearly was doing this to themselves, what would you tell them? Say those words to yourself. Because that's much more important than anything I'd ever tell you about why to stop smoking. It's a much more compelling argument than most of the ones we currently give. Which brings me to a topical issue that I added today. When you have a wonderfully talented person who hurts himself, despite the adoration most held for him, you begin to wonder, how is that possible? Because on the surface, he has everything. But of course, it's not that external world that brings the true happiness we seek. It's a deeper gratitude that we often sense. And addiction is unfortunately a chronic and deadly illness, as deadly as cancer, by the way, mathematically. It's underfunded in its treatment. And we often think of it as something that you sort of go back into rehab, you get better, then you're cured for a while, then maybe you'll have an issue, maybe not. It almost always comes back and tempts you and taunts you the entire rest of your life. And when I've done interviews with many people, some celebrities, some not, who have addiction issues, these themes resonate, they come out all the time. And especially with heroin and other opiates, it's become so easy because it's so much more powerful. I mean, the heroin of the 60s, when they were making them in kitchens in Harlem, is not the heroin that's made in chemical labs in South America, which is, you know, many, many times more powerful. And anesthesiologists, and I work with many anesthesiologists, have easy access to these narcotics. And I remember graduating in my residency class with the anesthesia group. And we had a great party that night, and one of my best friends was an anesthesiologist, and I went our different ways. He went home, and I didn't know this, put an IV in his arm and dosed himself up with narcotics and killed himself. And I never understood how he could do that, because it seemed so perfect with him all the time. And I realized that, as to my earlier point, the smarter you are, the better you are, not just at lying to yourself, but lying to others. And you could take those stories deeply into your, and the darkness that comes along with them, and hurt yourself. And this is emblematic of too many, you know, people who have been lost, some well-known, some not, but to that same ravaging problem of addiction. It's a medical problem, and we make it a psychological problem a lot of times. We say if you just work out the demons, you'll be fine, but they're deep-seated, innate, chemical dysfunctions of the brains of people with addictions, including cigarette smokers, that make it a much different challenge. So teasing them apart is important. Now let's go to the blood pressure. This is the major artery of the inside of your heart. That yellowish plaque is there when you're in your, you know, 18, 20 years of age. It starts to grow. By the time you're 45, 50, it gets larger. And then something happens. And it ruptures. You see it tear and break? That torn plaque now has platelets and other things that are sticking to it. And that blood clot that seeks to heal the damaged artery ultimately closes it off. And what you're about to witness, boom, right there. The blood vessel closed off. That's what a heart attack looks like. Now, it's a little scary when you see it, but I want you to feel empowered by that video. Because what I showed you was a heart attack that happened over hours, minutes. In fact, that's what normally happens. Which means, no matter what's going on today, if you change the odds of that happening, which you can do by what you have for dinner tonight, or had for dinner tonight, then it makes a difference. You have a huge amount of control over these episodes. And let me take you back to that risk factor I mentioned earlier, my list of five, high blood pressure. How does that correlate to this? So I want to punch a hole in the wall back there, right, which metaphorically is the wall of that artery. I have to fix that hole. Well, how does the body fix the hole? It fixes it with its own plaster. It's called cholesterol. And that cholesterol, if it's a nice, smooth, perfect repair, gives you a high quality improvement. But if it's cheap spackling, it crumbles out. And so too often, we're willing to tolerate the plaque that looked like that image looked. But go back a second. What made the hole in the artery? If there was no hole, you wouldn't need plaster. What makes the hole is high blood pressure. It squirts like a fire hydrant and scrapes off the lining of the blood vessels. Diabetes is like broken pieces of glass shards scraping the lining of the artery, scarring it, so the body has to put plaster on that. And cigarette smoking also damages the lining, which again leads to more plaque. So all these are common pathway where we end up with problems. The number one killer of all, related back to issues that I showed in that first image. So we're clear on that basic arrangement, and we have a huge amount of control over that. But how do I drive this point home? There's one uniquely effective way of doing it, which I'm going to segue to now, because it comes down to the issues, the last two issues that I had on that slide of five things, which is, are you what are you eating, and how are you exercising? So let's walk through perhaps the most obvious problem we have in America, which is obesity. I don't know how many of you made the tour through Europe and seen sculptures like this. Of course, we wouldn't have saved these if they had made them like this. But it is unfortunately a reality that if we're truly going to make a sculpture today, this is what it would have to look like. And The reason for it's a bit complex, but not so complex that you can't immediately process it and begin to use it. So I'm going to go through very briefly what's really happening. First issue, we always measure our weight. I think it's a big mistake. We should be much more interested in our waist size than our weight. Your waist size is a better definer of whether you're going to get sick or not. It's a better predictor of health risks, and it's easier to measure without the stigma of talking about someone's weight. I don't know how many of you saw the show I did last week where I dressed up in a 400-pound outfit. But it is, you know, a life-changing event to walk up around New York City in a 400-pound outfit. I mean, I sat in the city bus, people got up and moved away from me. Walking down the street, mothers had the children avert their eyes. I mean, you feel completely invisible, even though you're the biggest thing on the block. And I went to Jersey, had the exact same experience walking through malls. It's unbelievable what happens, which is why people who are overweight tend to feel down and tend to feel ashamed of who they are. And so oftentimes when they feel like that, they don't go to the doctor because they don't want to get weighed. So I pledged to everybody, and I asked the audience to do this as well, to stop allowing doctors to weigh you in the office, unless there's a compelling reason for it. Most of the time we can eyeball you and we sort of know if you're overweight. So putting you on the scale and mentioning 179, that doesn't really get us much further in the conversation. And it embarrasses women especially, so they don't go to us, and we end up with this big, you know, chasm between, you know, people who want to help and people who need help. So a much more comfortable tactic is to make it optional and then make it a little less predatory when you're getting weighed. And on the show, I'm not going to put people in the truth tube and insist on their weight anymore. I did that for years thinking it was helpful. I think it's actually embarrassing, so embarrassing that it holds people back. But if you're going to keep track of your size, maybe the best way is the waist, because it doesn't come along with all the baggage. And that waist size should be your height divided by 2. So if you're 5 feet 5 inches tall, right, that's 5 times 12 inches is 60 inches plus 5 is 65 inches, divided in half, 32.5 inches. And you get where you need to be. And if you're more than 32.5 inches in the waist size, you know you got a little extra weight going on board. And then the question is, what do? You actually have to measure it. You all know this, right? And especially the men out there, because I know that men after the age of 40 never buy a new belt size. Right? Well, they slip it down like this, right? And they walk around. And I got a 32-inch waist, and life's good. So if you, and women, please, you know, we at least have dress sizes in women, but you need to actually get the measuring tape out and do the measurement to make sure you're in the right path. Now, what about diets? Conventional diets, they just don't work because they depend on willpower. How many of you, put your hands up, can hold your breath indefinitely underwater? In the back? Okay. You can't do it. It's impossible. It's a foolish question to ask because it violates your basic biology. The biology of blubber likewise dictates that you must eat. There are a dozen redundant systems that force you to eat. There's no point wasting time trying to think any way around that. What you could do is nudge the biology of blubber in the right direction. So he decided in the first issue of the magazine to write a little bit about this. And I just, you know, we called Eat Like Dr. Oz. And because I wanted to at least say what I eat. And not that I figured it all out, I have plenty of flaws, but at least with food, I've thought carefully about what I really like to eat and what happens to be good for me, and I put those two Venn diagrams together and they overlap. And I picked those foods and made it part of my life. Just like each of you in your own way will make it happen. And if you appreciate that, then all of a sudden it becomes easier to do the right thing, which is part of the goal. So we have this little thing called OzWatch. I'm gonna just put it out there right now. I don't sell any products, I never have, I don't plan on selling any. So if you see someone with, you know, if you go home and Google my name tonight, you will start getting immediately spam emails from me trying to sell you things. And so we have this thing called OzWatch just to warn you. And I say that because I talk about weight loss on the show, and I talk about Garcinia Cambogia and green coffee bean extracts and a bunch of things that actually have been shown in clinical trials to work. But as soon as I mention them, they're out there being sold to people. Those products are of value, but that's not the foundation of how you're going to lose weight. The foundation of how you're going to lose weight is much more subtle than that. If you really want to do something that's worth your time, you can go to droz.com and we have a 2-week diet plan that has been downloaded 2 million times in the last few weeks. It's incredibly popular because it's basically a compilation of the things that I have found most useful from the guests I've had on the show for the last 5 years. And I just went to my producers who seemed to be disappearing in front of me. They were all losing a lot of weight, literally. And I kept wondering what was going on, and they had actually among themselves written up their own version of what they should do, which seemed to overlap a lot. We took their ideas, put it together, and that became the recipe for success. But I'm gonna give you a couple of the highlights of that. And these are the kinds of themes we're gonna, again, sprinkle through the magazine and all the things we try to do to make it easier for you to access them in a way you want them. Because I do want to be able to go deeper on topics when I need to, and you need to be able to take your time going through them and then tear the pages out, put them on the door you open most commonly in your house, which is which door? The refrigerator door. Put it on the refrigerator door and then follow the little, your own version of those rules that we've created for you. So let me go through a couple examples. First thing, in the morning when you get up, if you have a cup of coffee, the coffee itself isn't the problem, but the coffee with the cream and the sugar is a problem. And then the fact that the coffee is for many people a trigger to have a bagel or a Danish along with it, that becomes a catastrophe. So instead, a lot less caffeine, a lot more boost, a lot more phytonutrients to give you a little bang for their effort are green tea, which is what I usually have in the morning. And then I usually have a Greek Faggia yogurt, that's what I happen to personally like, but any kind of yogurt you like with blueberries for me, or you could have a, you know, there are a dozen different ways of getting there, but I know what I need in the morning, and this makes me feel satiated. And by the way, skim milk, please, just get it out of your refrigerator, throw it away. The biggest problem with skim milk is it makes you gain weight. And you all know why that's so, right? No, they don't know why that's so. I didn't think so. Yeah, exactly, sugar. If you take the fat out of milk, what's left? Sugar. It's basically a sugar drink. And the fat in milk actually seems to make your fat cells more comfortable so you don't crave more fat. And when your fat cells are more comfortable, remember, they're there to protect you. When they feel comfortable, guess what they do? They relax. So they let their fat stores go. So there have been actually studies being done looking at different kinds of fats. In fact, Friday's show is a show on different fats that actually help you eat your fat away. A good example are pine nuts. Pine nuts have PUFAs, polyunsaturated fatty acids. Clinical trials have demonstrated that snacking with PUFAs, like pine nuts and sunflower seeds, for example, as opposed to a Danish, have a salutary value in helping people get rid of belly fat. Now, if you eat 3,000 calories, it's not going to work. But if it could help you eat 1,500 or 1,800 calories, depending on your size, then yeah, that's a pretty good way to go. So green tea is a little tip. The other thing is hot sauces, picante sauce. Start when you're young. You know, if you're pregnant, and my daughter Daphne, you may know, Daphne hosts a show at ABC called The Chew with Mario Batali. So Daphne's 8 months pregnant. So I keep telling you, if she eats spicy foods, the baby will like them more, which is true. Whatever the mom eats, it sips into the amniotic fluid. The baby is bathed in these tastes, and they grow. They come out of the womb desiring these kinds of tastes more than if they didn't. So many cool things about pregnancy. But you know, the moms and all of us who eat picante sauces, the spicy sauces with capsaicin, tends to increase your metabolism, which is why you sweat. But it also reduces your appetite the next meal. And my favorite of all, nuts, tree nuts. And why do I like tree nuts? They're rich in the right kinds of fats, they have lots of fiber, they have lots of protein, but most importantly, I can put them in my pocket. I have nuts behind that door in my bag because I can walk around with them, they don't go bad that quickly, and I can eat them when I feel like I'm hungry. And so it's a very convenient way for me to titrate my appetite during the day. Unlike many people who get hungry, they have no food near them, so they go foraging like a rodent to the vending machines trying to find something to eat, and they're at the mercy of whatever's being sold there. So, you know, if nothing else from today's talk, when you go home, make sure you got nuts in every drawer, at work and everything else. And take the nuts from the back of the rack, because the nuts do go stale. So especially if a store's not selling a lot of nuts, you want to grab the ones in the back, they're fresher. Okay, exercise. It had to happen eventually, that I was going to talk about this theme. Many people despise exercise because it's uncomfortable. It makes them feel badly. They don't look good in their exercise clothes. The sun's in their eyes, you know, there's many reasons. My advice to you is to find a 10-minute little simple routine that works for you. I happen to do yoga in the morning when I get up, and I do some push-ups and sit-ups when I do them, but you find something that works for you, stretch out, limber up, get a little bit of something to get your heart rate going, and then you're done. By the time you start, you're finished. And don't make it an hour or 45 minutes, just make it 10 minutes, so you'll do it all the time. That way, nothing can hold you back. I mean, are you willing to admit your life is so out of control you don't have 10 minutes, right? It's impossible. You know, it's too embarrassing to acknowledge that. But an hour is a lot of time. So I think those kinds of tactics are effective. The other thing about exercise is don't do the same thing every single time. Vary it up a little bit. You want to go full speed once in a while. Now think back to yourself. When was the last time you really went full speed? But if you look at animals in the wild, it's a very different game. If you watch them hunting their prey, they'll do other things that ancient humans used to do. One of the simple things you'll see is a squat. And I don't know how many of you have done this. This is called Homo sapien pose number one. This is fundamental to what we were. We go to the bathroom in this pose, we sit in this pose. To get in this pose limbers up your hips. And as your hips limber up, you actually relax your lower back, your hamstrings go. If you have neck aches and pains, headaches, it all sort of begins to softly go away. And you can stay in this position for a long, long time without feeling the usual awkwardness of having to stand for a while, sit in the chair, or anywhere else. You don't even fidget in this position. So it's interesting to have a conversation this way, but people do this all the time. So these are the kinds of simple little tactics that become part of who you are. And as they become part of who you are, over the course of a few weeks, because you can't get rid of bad habits. You can only replace bad habits with good habits or other habits. These become the habits you become, they become part of who you are. Then people around you start talking about you because you're doing those things. And they begin to copy you, which we know to be the case because people who hang with thin people get thin and people who hang with heavy people get heavy. And don't say it's purely genetic because people who are heavy tend to have heavy pets. They do. So you see these trends because you created this story that you begin to weave into a fable and you know becomes a truth, right? They start as cobwebs, but they become cables over time as you reinforce them. So go back to that concept of what would have happened 100 years ago, 1,000 years ago. And you look at animals hunting their prey, and you see there's not an ounce of fat on them. I mean, they look at them as seamlessly able to get, and watch it chase down, it's about to take it. But can you do this too? Darn right you can do this. You have every ability to capture from behind. Without any question at all, if you go full speed, you'll be able to do anything you want to do. And you shouldn't let external beliefs of what you can do influence that. You know, our peak activity level, ability to jump our highest, be our strongest, is age 27. And then it's a downhill course from there. Pretty depressing, isn't it? But it doesn't matter how you jump. It doesn't really matter how strong you are in the moment. What really matters is your endurance. How long can you go? Because life's not a wind sprint anyway. It's a marathon. Turns out your endurance at age 17 is the same as age 65. Think about that. The next time you're sitting around, you know, moping around, figuring if you should go out and do something, 17-year-olds and 65-year-olds have the same basic innate endurance level. Now, why would we be created to have that? We only bear children until we're 50. So why would we have the ability to endure so well? Because our ancestors, when they were hunting their prey, they did not run the antelope. They out-endured the antelope. We'd run after the antelope because we could sweat and breathe, and the antelope can only sweat from its mouth. So it's running around, it's faster, it'd go away, and then we'd keep running after it. It'd have to stop, we'd come after it. And after about 2 hours, the antelope would fall over because it was exhausted. We'd stab it and eat it, right? That's, so if you go to the Tarahumara Indians, for example, in Mexico, these are 85-year-old people running 25, 30 miles a day just for fun. And they're reproducibly doing this without the kinds of problems we sometimes run into. So be smart about it, but never think that you're not supposed to be able to be an endurance athlete well into your 60s. And you can keep going well beyond that without difficulty. Even sexual activity. A quarter of octogenarians still have sex. Right? God bless them. And that's wonderful. And it could be much higher if people didn't put artificial barriers to make themselves think that it's not supposed to happen after this age. Because there aren't any rules like that. So let's talk about the last, and I think the most underappreciated health problem we have, and then I want to take questions. Sleep. Why is sleep so important? Growth hormone is the fundamental vitality hormone of the body. Without growth hormone, you don't feel as young, you don't look as young, you don't act as young. The number one way we get growth hormone is through sleep. And as it begins to diminish, both the growth hormone and our ability to sleep, we pay a terrible price. So the question then becomes, why don't we sleep? It turns out at least half of the time, it's about sleep hygiene, which is not understanding how basic things influence us, like lights. When lights are visible to our eyes, it turns off the ability of the pineal gland to make melatonin. Without melatonin, you don't glide into sleep. Forget this myth about falling to sleep. You don't fall anywhere. You have to glide into sleep gently. So turning your lights down about a half hour before bedtime, or using orange lights. Now they have new LED lights which don't emit any of those bright blue rays that awaken us. Hugely valuable in allowing us to slowly feel more tired. If that doesn't work, you can try melatonin. But if you're gonna try melatonin, don't take the usual doses because they're far too high. You want about half a milligram of melatonin. So it's, you know, about half the dose that most people are started on. Or take melatonin in a natural form, like tart cherry juice or a form like that, because you can take it in a, you know, normal part of your diet. And you don't want to take melatonin at bedtime, because guess what? Your body has to absorb it through the stomach and then has to send it to the brain. It takes 2 hours to do that. So have your melatonin or your tart cherry juice in place of dessert. And then 2 hours later, you'll start to feel the effect. And it's not magic. You don't pass out. But it makes it a little easier if you're doing the other things to head in the right direction. Loose pajamas, hugely valuable. Reduce ambient noise, especially in the city. It's a big issue. Don't think that the small little, you know, fire engine here and there doesn't make, it makes a big difference. It takes you from a very, very deep level of sleep to a lighter level, or from a light level out of sleep. It's the quality of sleep that suffers oftentimes. Look at your cell phone. Your cell phone should not be within 5 feet of your head when you fall asleep. It's been demonstrated to influence the patterns of sleep that you have. So for a variety of reasons besides the light, you want to get those away from you, those devices. It's not because you're going to get brain cancer. It's because you're not going to sleep well and be miserable, which is something you'll pay a price for tonight. Then you should move the cell phone away from your head when you go to sleep and get the room cold. You know, most people do not sleep well above 68 degrees Fahrenheit. When you're fighting with your spouse, remember that the worse you sleep, the colder the room has to be. And if you really can't get cold enough, put socks on, because socks will keep your feet warm, which allows your body to get cold. And these are simple little tactics. Sleep specialists know them. I don't know why we haven't told everyone in America these ideas, but they really do work pretty effectively. And let me leave you with this idea of hostility and anger. You know, driving over here from the office, we were, you know, cut off by a cab. And I got angry. It's snowing, it's bad weather anyway. You got people barking up at you. Getting angry at that person was a very appropriate response. Defensible, I don't know, but it's, you know, it could happen. And then, of course, the worst thing to tell someone who's angry is what? Calm down. Why? Because anger calls for action. That's the whole point. The opposite of anger is not calm. The opposite of anger is empathy. Understanding he was trying to pick up a client or get home to his family or whatever reason there was for making that weird move. But wishing he would die, right? That's hostility. It's a whole different ballgame. If you don't feel like you're a raindrop falling into the ocean of humanity, you don't feel the connection. You don't feel the connection to the good life, to what we really do crave, that authentic interaction that I spoke of at the very beginning of this conversation. And without that, you can't do the things you want to do in life. So my little tactic I'll share with you is to take a wine bottle, drink the wine, then take the cork, and save the cork, and you put it in your mouth like this. It's incredibly effective. It relaxes your mandible and your jaw. Okay. And as you relax the masseter muscle, this big, thick muscle, this joint, the TMJ joint, is the only joint that purposefully disarticulates. It pulls out of socket and back in every time you chew. It relaxes this incredibly complex joint. And the best part about this is if you're driving along with that cork in your mouth, people won't talk to you. It's very calming. This image, I write the very first article in the magazine and the very last article in the magazine. And I intend, and I have been reading every single article in between them, but those two I write myself. And I wrote this month's, I'm gonna go ahead and show it to you. I read this month's issues on optimism, where I talked about focusing on kindness and avoiding this concept of catastrophizing, making things worse than they seem. But next month, I'll show you a little insight. I'm planning on writing about this. This is a tree ring. And I show it because you see this tree had good and bad days. You notice the growth center is not in the middle. It's overgrown on one side, thrived, and then it sort of stunted on the other side. Then something bad happened at the 6 o'clock there that the other side didn't feel. At its very core, we're defined by everything that makes us. All of our life experiences make us who we are. This tree specimen is defined by good and bad, but in its entirety, it makes up what it is. And I'm thoughtful about this process because I'm raising 4 kids, and my wife and I talk about what to give them, what not to give them. And I'm always reminded that when you give your kids something you didn't have growing up, you take from them something you did have. And sometimes we don't realize that the shape of our lives, the good and the bad that go along together, does make us that whole, that makes us unique and special and worthy of further study. And it's that intriguing element that to me has always made life much more interesting. Because like you, my life is defined by the people in my life. And that's one of the reasons I get up so excited every single morning. So if you give your heart a reason to keep beating, it always will. And I'll leave you with that treatise as I turn to your questions. Thank you for coming out tonight. So, I've got questions. There are no names on these, so I can't call on you or embarrass you. When's the best time? We're going to do rapid fire. I've got about 10 questions here, but I'll get them all pretty quickly. When's the best time to take your vitamins? You should split your vitamins half of the morning, half of the evening. That's because a lot of the water-soluble vitamins, vitamin Bs, they're 9 B vitamins, they tend to be urinated out pretty quickly. So if you can take it half in the morning, half in the evening, you'll get maximum benefit. I know there's a ton of literature out there about vitamins now, big debate about whether you should take them at all. We're pretty confident that in healthy people who eat well, and physicians, for example, the role of vitamins is questionable. But that's not where most of America lives. We know the food supply itself has changed a bit, doesn't have nutrient value that it used to have. We also know most of us don't eat well, generally, every single day. So I personally take a multivitamin, and I take an omega-3 fat as well. So it's not a lot to ask myself and my wallet. It's what I recommend on the show as well. But I would split the multivitamin in 2 doses. Are near-death experiences, in your opinion, real or hallucinations? I think they're real. I understand medically why they happen. They're watershed areas of the brain where the blood doesn't directly go, it sort of seeps over there. And those watershed areas tend to be the parts of the brain that connect to where our senses come in. So the occipital lobe has eyesight, the temporal lobe has hearing. And so if we're dying and the blood supply is dropping, the connection between our hearing and our eyesight gets broken. And so you have out-of-body sensations. And I've taken care of too many patients who were really near death. And were able to crawl their way out of that abyss of darkness back onto the ledge of life and have come back to me with very accurate and reproducible stories of what happened. I remember one gentleman in particular who had been a Vietnam vet who was completely inoperable. I should never have taken him to the OR, but he told me that he had seen death fighting in Vietnam. He knew he wasn't going to die on my operating room table, and he insisted that I operate on him. So I operated on him, and he bled a lot. And ultimately, after 3 days of bleeding, he survived, something that he should never have been able to do. He turned out to be completely right, way beyond my expectations. So I asked him what happened in those 3 days, and he said he felt like he was a bug in an ether floating around, and he saw a light, and he just knew that if he lost the light, he'd die. So he kept on pushing himself in this thick goo towards that light, and when he finally got under it, he felt he'd come out of it and had awakened. Now, how much of that is hallucinations and how much is near-death, I don't know, but this has been studied. I've had numerous people at my show who have spoken about this, and there's too much consistency in the experience. So either there's a well-defined medical phenomenon that we don't yet understand, or something magical is happening out there that we'll all eventually taste firsthand. But from my perspective, I'm leaning towards there's being some reality there. Dr. Oz, you got only one piece of advice that you can give. I'm sorry, if you can give only one bit of advice to people over 60, not me, of course. That's what she writes. What would be your one pearl of wisdom? I shared it a bit in the discussion, but it would be to get daily activity that is somewhat exertional. And I'll mention one statistic. If you look at people who can walk a quarter mile, if you cannot walk a quarter mile in 5 minutes, your chance of dying dramatically increases. So it's the basic level of activity is essential for us to survive as an individual. It makes us focus on balance and strength and a little bit of agility to walk that quarter mile. And in New York City, it's a walking city. It's something we can all aspire to do once the snow clears. From our live stream audience, hi live stream audience on the web, is 30 minutes of exercise enough for a woman over 55? 30 minutes of activity is enough. You don't have to get more than that. In fact, if you get too much activity, there's a decrease in your survival rate. An hour's even better than 30 minutes, but I'd much rather you just get your 30 minutes in and enjoy life and not fixate on it. Exercise should not block you from enjoying life. It should make life more fun. And if you exercise and feel worse when you're done, you're doing too much. You should be lifted up by the experience. That's why yoga is so valuable for me, because it allows me to focus and then relax in the same time, so that when I'm done, my mind is clear. What excites you most in your day-to-day life? Getting yelled at by my wife. Like most men, it is really a thrill to bug her. And she calls me the meddler, because I'll look at something she did and I'll meddle with it and throw away weeks of hard work. But what I do really like is the way that we press each other's buttons. And she makes every day of my life worth living, and she is remarkably adept at making sure I stay on target. On what I need to do and on message and on brand, and most importantly, don't do things that are stupid. But marrying her was the smartest thing and the best luck I ever had in my life. Don't tell her I said that. Is there anything that I want to improve on? Yes, I don't manage. My desire to be efficient, I become inefficient. I don't know if any of you live this in your own lives, but there are times I'm doing everything so perfectly that I spend more time planning doing it perfectly than actually doing it and experiencing it. And I speak about things, many of them I don't do well, which is why I understand them so well, because I think I should be able to do them better. But most importantly, when I don't focus on what I'm really doing in the moment, it drives me batty. And I see myself doing it frequently when I'm planning the next event while I'm currently in something else. And that's not how life's meant to be lived. Would you want your daughter to be a doctor? I very much want one of my kids to be a doctor. It is an absolute blessing of a field. A doctor, nurse, respiratory therapist, physical therapist, something in the healing profession. It is an incredible blessing that I appreciated when I was about 7 or 8 years of age, because I would go with my dad to make rounds. And my dad was a really fast walker, and I'd be scurrying along behind him as fast as I could to keep up. And he'd walk into people's rooms who were clearly in pain and do things to them that seemed to make the pain not better, like putting needles in them and things. And they would always cheer up when he walked in. And I realized after a while that what he gave them was hope. And hope's not about the right thing happening, because sometimes you don't have control over that. Hope is about making sense of what is happening and making peace with it, which is what a true healer does. So I'm hoping that one of my kids, I have high hopes for my third daughter, who is a freshman in college. She's leaning that way a little bit. But unless she knows that I want her to be a doctor, in which case I'm sure she won't become a doctor. You talked about how important spending time with your family is, especially when it comes to living the good life. What's your favorite way to spend time with the family? We're a big board game family and sports game. We compete in everything. So on a day like today, if I wasn't with you, and I want you feeling guilty now, but if I wasn't with you, I'd be at home playing Oz Olympics. What we do, here's how we play Oz Olympics. Every kid gets to play a sport they're really good at. So I'm pretty sure they'll win that event. And then we have a couple general events that they all have to compete in, usually that none of them are that good at. For example, we play board games, but they're full contact. So, have you, any of you played Cards Against Humanity?
Yes.
That's a very popular game for us. Awkward as it is, but yeah, those are the ways we play, we compete. And usually someone wins and someone loses, and they fight about who really won and lost. But we do all those things, and I learned a lot from, because it's very hard for me to understand my kids through their homework. I've always had a difficult time knowing, if Oliver's really good at history, does that mean he's coping with life well? I can't tell. But I can watch him perform, playing against his sister in basketball, and I'm pretty sure how he's dealing with adversity and failure and success. And so I push them in that way to at least let me see what they're doing so I can offer my thoughts. And if they want to ignore, at least I feel better about it. You recommend that all women in their 40s take a baby-coated aspirin. I would take a baby-coated aspirin once my menstruation cycle, if I was a woman, had slowed down, gone away. For most men over age 40, I think it makes sense. I take an aspirin, two baby aspirin. Why two rather than one? About a quarter of us don't really respond to a baby aspirin. Genetically, we're different from each other. So two baby aspirin guarantees you with the impact of the aspirin, which is not just to thin your blood, it's also an antioxidant, very potent antioxidant, an anti-inflammatory agent. That's the real reason I like it. Women can wait till about age 50 to start their aspirin. There are theoretical risks and pros and cons. It's a big discussion. I'm giving you my perspective, having looked at all the literature, and my bias. And this is true for the magazine, the show, everything else I do. I give you the advice I give my own family. And you can argue against it, and you're well within your rights, and there's good arguments against taking baby aspirin, but I reckon that my family take it from my perspective. Is there one thing, three more left, is there one thing I could do for 5 minutes every single day that would improve my life? If you do that little squat that I showed you, and just do that while you're on the phone talking to somebody, just do that for 5 minutes, so easy to do, you'll enjoy that process. And you'll enjoy the limberness that it brings your hips. If you had one day all to yourself with no commitments or requirements, what would I do? I'd force my kids to play football with me, that's what I get for my birthday every year. I have a big yoga party at my house where I invite a lot of friends over, and we all do yoga and sweat, and then we have a lunch afterwards. But I tell my kids that I don't want them buying me anything because they're buying it for me with my own money anyway, so that's what I want them to do is to make me something with their own hands So they can make me, you know, they make me little music videos. They're very creative when they're forced to be creative, kids are, if they don't get in their way, or they have to play sports with me. So they can choose, they gotta choose as a group, and then they just, what do they do? We go that way fully. And how, last question, how do you get up and get going in the morning? I am just like you in the morning. I get up some mornings and I feel, geez, I'm really, really not in the mood to get up. I do everything I can to get my 7.5 hours of sleep, and I'm religious about it. But I get tired as well. So I get up, I do what's called the hippie stretch. And the hippie stretch is this. I lean forward, and when you lean forward, you don't clasp like this, right? You wanna lean forward at your hips. So I gather the air up on either side, and I come down, I touch my toes, and then I break my one hip, my left knee, like this, and that relaxes my left hip, but puts a little tension, a fair amount of tension in my right hip. Then I go backwards the other way. I look like a hippie like this. Relax my head, and this is the hippie stretch. And I do that in the morning when I first get up, and it makes everything easier. It's been a real blessing to spend time with you. I have one. We were thinking about how to give you back a gift for braving the cold weather today. So each of you, as you leave, if you desire it, will get an issue of the first magazine, which comes out tomorrow. So I hope you enjoy it.